the corner.
Oh, is the light supposed to be on?
Only if it needs it.
Only if it needs it, okay. That's our backup.
It's on auto mode, so.
Okay.
No, it's on.
Okay. Okay. We're here interviewing. My name is Julie Upstill. I'm the granddaughter of Harold Eldsworth Williams. We are in Chatham, New York. Interviewee's birthday is January 23rd, 1923. People attending the interview today is myself, Julie Upstill, the interviewee, granddaughter, Harold Williams, war veteran of World War II, camera operator, my husband Peter Upstill, and wife to Harold Williams, Marie Williams. Today is December 28th, 2007. And I am not working with an organization. This is a private interview. Okay. Grandpa, and I'm going to probably refer to you as Harold during the interview today. Could you please state what war and branch of service you were in?
World War II, and I was in the 62nd Armored Field Artillery Battalion, the U.S. Army.
And what was your rank?
Oh, technician, fifth grade.
Okay, and where did you serve?
Well, when we left the States, we went to Africa. It was the it was the beginning of the war with the Germans, and we went all through Africa. And then after Africa, we went to Sicily, and we made the D-Day landings there. And the particular craft that I was on D-Day at Licata, Sicily, and Omaha, or Licata, on the beach of Gala, I guess was actually the name of the town, we were the only craft in our outfit that suffered tremendous casualties. We had 98 that were wounded on the ship we were on, and that only lasted 30 days. That war in Sicily was over quick. And from then on it was bivouacked by the ocean, swimming, eating, and taking it easy. And after we left there, we thought that perhaps we were going to train for Italy, but they had a surprise for us, I guess, on June 6, 1944, but we didn't know that then. Mm. So we were on the U.S., or the HMS, His Majesty's ship, the Orange, and we sailed from Palermo, the capital city of Sicily. And from there we went up the Mediterranean, which was loaded with German subs, and nobody wanted to sleep below. Everybody slept on top till we got through the Rock of Gibraltar. And we stopped there, and they showed us a great display of how powerful that was. Protected because it was one of the most highly protected terra firma on the earth, because that's where all supplies went through to Russia. Hmm. They had to go through the Strait of Gibraltar. So there we went to England, landed up at Scotland, up at Glasgow, and from there they shipped us to a little town of Banbury, England, and there we danced and made merry while we were waiting for the what they had in store for us. We trained in England. We trained at Slapton Sounds. It was supposed to be the real thing. Unfortunately, what happened was some German T-boats, whatever they call them, they're little fast boats. They snuck in behind us. And they knocked out two of our LSDs, and 1,500 men drowned there. Mm. It was a great loss. It was kept secret. It was not really spoken of much. And from there we we went to down to Southampton, England, and we knew now that we were heading for somewhere, and we were confined, supposed to be, but some of us decided that we wanted to leave, and I went back to see my fiance, and the MPs were very kind, didn't bother us, let us through, and when I went back, I got a telephone call. I was there from Jackson, an old friend of mine, who is now gone. He called and said, "You better get back, Willie." He says, something's going on. So I hurried back, and good thing I did. And at 2 o'clock next morning, we were walking down the streets to the harbor to, near Southampton. I think it was Weymouth, and Portsmouth. And that's, we went aboard some old clunky craft, and then we knew it was a real thing. They came through the ships, so I'm sure all the ships are the same, with a message from General Eisenhower, General Eisenhower, telling us that the eyes of the world were on us, and that people were praying for us and that. And boy, then we knew we were on the way, and that night we left June 5th. For what we didn't know was known as Omaha Beach. There was four beaches. Omaha was the only one that was really protected. Others, they had problems too, but it was nothing like Omaha. They were waiting for us. And as we were going in to the beach, I guess the fear of God was in us, because we could see guys floating all over the place. So we knew it was rough in there. And as we approached the beach, they came out with a big foghorn and a little small craft. And I can't tell you exactly the language they used, but they told us to get off, that we wouldn't stand a chance. And we were not hit. I don't know why. Everything was being hit around us. So, but anyway, they backed us off, and we just watched the sideshow for a while. And finally, when they brought us in, we were told to, when the ramp dropped, to get off the beach as quick as we could. And we tried to dock our ramp, but there was too many guys laying around, so some of the guys jumped off, put the bodies on one side, they let the ramp down. And we took off as fast as we could off that beach. We went by a truck going up the beach. Boy, that guy had guts. They were trying to pick up the wounded and just throw them in the truck, but I guess he got hit too. I don't really know, because we went up the ravine. General Bennett was on the beach with guys trying to, well, he was a colonel then, Colonel Donald B. Bennett. He was our commander all through Africa and Sicily and all through France, Belgium, Holland, Germany, and Czechoslovakia. He took us in, and with the 16th Infantry Regiment, the boat he was on was hit, and they jumped off early as they approached the beach. There was seven, I think, from the 62nd with Bennett, and they jumped off, and the poor coxswain from the Navy and the other guys, they hit it direct and blew it up. As far as he knew, none of them made it, but he was the highest ranking officer left alive after the first wave. His friend Colonel McQuaid got hit direct. They never even found his body, but it was chaos. but we were proud to say that we served under Don Bennett. He's a good man. And I had the privilege of going and visiting with my son David. And we had a lot of things to talk about, but the one thing he said, I had to disagree with him. He said, you know, Cornwell, he says, I don't think I did enough to save men's lives. And I said to him, that's not true, Don. You did all you could. What more could you do? And then he started talking about going up the hill to that one gun emplacement that had killed so many of our men. And he said, that was a tough one, wasn't it, Willie? I says, I don't know. I was not with you, Don, on that one. I'm glad I wasn't. But he felt that he didn't do enough to save lives that day. But God knows he did. He got hit twice and still wouldn't evacuate. So anyway, we went through across the continent and wound up with the Russians. And I guess one of the worst sights we never thought we were going to see was the concentration camp where they had the Jewish people in there and burned them alive. And that was a mess. And we had problems with the Russians. We thought World War III was going to start, but thank God it didn't. They tried to break through our... We each had an embarkation point, and our part was on one side of the river, and their part was on the other, and they wanted to come across and go through the towns, and we knew what they were doing over there. They were doing things I don't want to talk about to people, and we told them they couldn't go by, and thank God they didn't. They went back across the river. And then from then on, they started picking guys out to go home. And the strange thing was, a fellow that I was in the service with, we met at the beginning of the war, and we went to Fort Knox, Kentucky, and took our training and armored infantry, and also a radio operator for forward observation and artillery. We took that training, and they broke us up, and they sent me down to Camp Campbell, and gosh, I bumped into him down there, so we were back together again. Then they separated us, and we went overseas, and dug on. We met up again in Casablanca, and we were both replacements in the 62nd Armored Field Artillery Battalion. That was our outfit had been already committed to combat, and they took us up as replacements for casualties. And went all through the war together, and afterwards they started sending people home, and they sent some of them to England, and I went back to England, and when I was there, I bumped into Jackson again, and I thought he was gone home, and then we got separated again to go home, and then coming into Boston Harbor, doggone it, if I didn't walk down the railing there looking over at Boston, and I looked up and here comes Jackson. So we were 1, 2, 3, 4 times separated and brought back together again. So it was quite a story, because usually when you get broke up, you don't get back together again. That was great. Jackson's gone now too.
Do you remember Jackson's full name?
Yeah. Jackson, I got it down here somewhere. He had a habit of saying onlyest. He couldn't say you're the only one. He would say you're the onlyest one. So we nicknamed him Onlyest Jackson, but his real name was Clarence. Clarence Jackson from Funston, Georgia. He ran a bee apiary down there.
Okay. Yeah. And how did you get your nickname, Corn Willie?
Well, I'll tell you, there's two or three guys that I can look back on, but I think the one was Haygood. You see, every once in a while we'd get a warm meal. Most of the time we just ate out of cans and that. But when they'd give us a little rest for a day or two, the service battery'd come up and they'd make breakfast and dinner and supper. And they always had for breakfast this hash. It was corned beef and hash and stuff, all potatoes mixed together. And I liked it, but the other guys hated it. So one day, I remember Haygood said to me, Cornwell, he says, anybody eat that stuff would eat anything. And they just picked on me bad about that. called me, that's where I got the name Cornwell from. And I remember when General Bennett called me up, he called me Cornwell.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to take you back to the beginning of your service time. How did you come to joining the Army? Did you get drafted or were you enlisted?
No, I enlisted.
Okay, and how old were you?
18. I'll be 18 going on 19. I think it was 18 and a half I was. It was June. Yeah, June 12, 1942, when I enlisted.
Yep. Okay, and where were you living when you enlisted?
In Albany.
Okay. And why did you enlist in the Army?
Well, I don't know why I enlisted. When the Japanese hit us, that made all the young men in the country very angry, and I guess I just wanted to do my part like everybody else.
Okay. Do you recall your first days in the service?
Oh, yeah. Down at Camp Kilmer, New Jersey. Know it very well, yeah. They used to get us up early, and we'd run a couple of miles and then come back and have breakfast. And as we broke up, he'd say, is anybody here? He says, know how to drive a truck. And, of course, I went right up. And... good, he says, step out. And a couple of other guys took us down the kitchen, showed us these big stainless steel carts that you put your pans and pots and pans on. You wheel them down to the kitchen to be washed. So that was the last time I volunteered for anything.
What did it feel like going through boot camp for you?
I guess the worst part was in the morning. I just hated to get up that early, boy, and run. I didn't like that, but whoa, if you didn't get out of that bed when, I can't remember his name, but I know he was one mean cuss. But I guess he was doing it for our benefit, which I didn't understand.
Do you remember your instructors in boot camp? Were they like? I mean, were they tough?
Oh, yeah. They had to be. I mean, they were doing it for our own good. At that time, we didn't think so, but... Yeah. Oh, yeah.
How much time did you spend in boot camp?
13 weeks.
13 weeks in New Jersey.
Yep. And then they sent us down to Fort Knox, Kentucky.
Okay.
That's where we took our armored infantry and radio operator. Because Jackson and I both wound up as radio operators, forward observers with the infantry.
Okay.
We didn't know it was going to be like that. We thought it was fun tapping on them keys. We had to learn 20 words a minute.
20 words a minute, okay.
Yeah, 20 words a minute before you could get your certificate.
Okay.
I hardly ever used it because we had the little 510s, the receiver and the transmitter, like we carried with us. We very seldom, the only time we would use them is if we wanted to code something out. But the Germans knew all our codes, so we didn't use it.
Okay.
We needed the Indians with us. They're the ones that, they were the real heroes of the war.
And did you serve with any Indians?
No. They were all in the Pacific.
Okay. And how long were you in Fort Knox before you were shipped out to Africa?
Fort Knox, we were there, I think another 12, 13 weeks, something like that. 3 months. And okay. Then they sent us down to Camp Campbell. We weren't there very long.
Okay.
Yeah. Then they sent us up to Camp Kilmer, New Jersey, and we knew we were on our way.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so from the time that you left boot camp and you spent the 12 to 13 weeks in Fort Knox, how long was that before you went to Africa first,
yeah,
correct?
Yeah, we went straight to Africa. Yeah.
And how long was that time period?
From Camp Kilmer, I think it was probably 3.5-4 days. I can't remember how long it took to cross now.
Okay.
Yeah. But we couldn't get into Casablanca because some of the ships had been sunk there, and they didn't want to take a chance of going in, so they took us up to Oran. And when we got there, we wished that we'd have gone to Casablanca, because Oran, the French were fighting against us at that time. Later on became our... but they were fighting against us that time. We lost some men there. We didn't personally, but other outfits did.
What were your feelings as you were heading to Africa? I mean, was it a reality of what you were going into, or...
Well, I'll tell you, I was so seasick and hanging my head over the deck that I just wanted to get off the ship. And a lot of guys were like that. And a lot of guys got very sick. It was very rough. It was in February.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so... do you remember arriving in Africa and what that was like for you?
Well, it was kind of scary. We went into Oran, that's the port there, because the Americans were being shelled by the French up on the cliffs, but they got rid of them real quick.
Okay.
Yeah. And then the Free French forces came in and took over and got rid of them. They were just people that had sided in with the Germans and that.
So how long were you there for?
Not very long. We went on up to forgot the name of the little town, but it was there where they were grouping guys together, new guys coming in like we were,
mm-hmm.
and putting them in different outfits, replacements, you know. And we didn't know. They just put us in a jeep and told us we were going up to the front. And it was just Jackson and I. They said they needed some radio operators. So they dropped us off, and I remember they called it Stuka Lane, and I wondered why, but I found out later, because the Germans had air superiority. And they used to go down through their strafing every day. Every 3 or 4 hours they'd come through. And they dropped us off, and I remember, I said, where do I go? And some guy said to me, well, why don't that tent over there? So just about that time, this guy had a half track, and he was inside the half track at the time. And I walked up to him, I got acquainted with him, and I went into the half track with him, and all of a sudden he says, come on, let's go. I found out what he meant. I could hear the strafing, and I ran and got in a foxhole with him. And I'm not going to tell you what happened in that foxhole, boy, but I was scared. It put the fear of God in me. So that's how I was introduced to the 10 minutes after we got there. They start. So that's how I was introduced to the fear of war.
So your combat experience and your job assignments, I mean, you said that you didn't really use your radio operating skills as much as you probably thought you were going to.
Well, the only time you would use them is when you went out on patrol with the infantry. Other than that, we didn't use the code.
Okay.
Once in a while, we'd do it for practice and that, just to keep up with our training and that. But we, in combat, we didn't. We used the radios, the little 510s.
Okay. And what was your combat experience like?
Well, the 62nd Armored Field Artillery had one of the longest records of combat in World War II, because they started in Africa and went all through the war. We had 424 days of actual combat with the 62nd. In fact, we were one of the very few that had the four landings. And these four landings were, and of course the silver one was for Omaha Beach, but we had three landings: Africa, Sicily, and Omaha Beach.
Now, you just talked about Africa, and at the beginning you talked a little bit about Sicily, and you lost, I think you said, around 1,500 men In Sicily, was it?
In Sicily, on our boat, on our craft, on our LST we were on, what happened was it got grounded, and it couldn't get off the sandbar. Mm. And it was the only one that got grounded. So there was a big cliff right over us, and they would come right over the cliff and drop quick and then disappear. No, the biggest loss of men in Sicily was when our own artillery killed hundreds of paratroopers. They thought it was the Germans coming over, and they got mixed up. The 101st Airborne, 82nd Airborne, they lost an awful lot of men. It was enemy, friendly fire.
Friendly fire.
Yep. You can imagine what.
And when was that discovered, that it was actually our own men?
Well, when they started picking them out of the water, I guess. I don't know. I can't. Mm-hmm. I really don't know when they first discovered it.
Okay. But. And in regards to your unit, how many casualties do you think that you suffered?
Well, we always thought of ourselves as the lucky 62nd. I don't know the exact number, because you see there was service battery, A battery, B battery, C battery, and headquarters. So you had five batteries. And the only ones you were really acquainted with was your own immediate battery. Because the 105s that we would call in the fire for the infantry, they would be back, because we'd be up in the infantry. So I really can't say. We figured that the number of days we were in combat, that God really really protected us, because we didn't lose as many as a lot of other outfits did. Our greatest loss was on the beach in Omaha. I don't know how many were there. The first one craft that got off, first 105 that got off, it was demolished. That's the one Jerry Eades was on. He's the one that kept us together all the years. He jumped out and ran up the beach, got against the wall, and became an infantryman immediately. That's the way it was that day. Everybody became infantry.
Who made the decision when you were in the boat to sit back and to see what was going to happen? Who made that decision on that boat that day?
Well, it was a little craft that came out. Mm-hmm. It was a kind of a small boat. I think it was a Navy guy that had been taking guys in, and that he came out to tell us that we wouldn't stand a chance if what we were supposed to be was the secret weapon of the whole war. They were rhinos. They were flat, just like this floor. And in the back of them, they had a U-cut like, and it was a big engine in the back. And in the front, there was places for to hook onto, and in the back, we were supposed to go in, and we were supposed to beach, drop the engine in the water, let the next one come up and hook onto it. Drop that engine in the water, let the, supposed to be a bridge, but never used in one of them. There was no room for them in the first place. The only word to describe it is chaos, carnage.
How long do you remember sitting back for before you guys made the decision to land on the beach?
Oh, we were right near the beach all the time, but we didn't actually get our craft on the beach until about 6 hours later.
Okay.
Yeah.
At that point, what were you feeling? Did you feel like there was no going back? You just...
Oh, we had to go in. We had to go in. They had to have the 105s. They needed the half-track. They needed the 50 calibers. We were tied up to a mercy ship that night, I remember, that was only for the wounded. And we weren't really supposed to do it, because we had combat equipment, and that was all marked for, which the Germans didn't honor anyway, but it was all marked for, you know, wounded and that. And I remember we had no food on that, so they let down over the sides a big garbage can. Of course, I'm sure it was scalded and clean, but full of coffee, and another one with oatmeal in it, and they let it down so we'd have some food over the night. But the strafing all night long, they had these little cables going up with the things over them, like a dirigible or something, or whatever you call them. They were like balloons. They were supposed to keep the enemy from getting too low to strafe and that, but it didn't work. All night long was strafing.
After you landed on the beach, how much time did you spend? I mean, what was that experience like once you got on the ground and were with General Bennett or Colonel Bennett at the time?
Well, Bennett was up ahead of us. When we finally got in and had to drop the ramp, of course, some guys jumped off and he had to move bodies aside so we could let our ramp down and get our equipment off. But once we got on the beach, the shelling and that, we were told to just take off, and that's all we did. We the half track. Old Boleyn, he was a Bulligan guy. I remember old Boleyn, he was the driver. And boy, he put that thing in, he took off. We used our 50 caliber all the way up the beach. We had to. That was the only firepower real, because none of the big guns were in at all. They hadn't brought them in yet. The 105s, they lost the first couple, so they decided not to bring any more in because it was suicide, And you can't, if you're going to lose the crew, what good can you do the infantry? Mm-hmm. So that's why they decided to wait a few hours later to bring them in. And then they lost them at that. Lost some of them drowned in that, in the water and that. It was a bad tide that day. It was not a good day at all.
And when you were on the ground, who were you with? I mean, do you remember being with certain soldiers?
Yeah, there was Boleyn and myself and Ike Munoz. Old Ike. Where are you, Ike? Right here. Old Ike and I, we were on it together. The rest of the guys, some of them got hurt. Some of them are not here anymore. So that's...
Okay. May 1945, that one.
That was taken. That's, yep, so we linked up with the Russians. Yep.
What would you say would be, well, a couple of them. I'm sure you have many of them, your memorable experiences of the war.
Well, I guess one of the most memorable experiences I had was my squad leader, Ray Singleton. Him and I, we were quite close. And we were doing hedgerow to hedgerow at the time, and you never knew where the Jerries were, so we thought we'd be smart. We went to a German house, and we saw the chickens out there, so we went in the coop and started getting eggs and that, and they came out yelling at us, and so we just gave them some sea rations and some chocolate bars, cigarettes, and they were happy. And Ray and I thought that was fun because we had about three or four eggs. And we had a little gas stove. We used to prime them and then light them, and you could cook on them. And we were cooking the eggs, and all of a sudden a shot rang out. And it scared the daylights out of me because Ray hollered, "Oh my God, Willie," he says, "I'm hit." I thought he was kidding. I looked down and saw the blood running out of his pant legs and that. So I started running all over the place hollering for a medic because I didn't know where any medics were at that time. And they were hollering, "Get out of here, Dan, fooled." But I knew Ray needed a medic. So when I got the medic for him, they put him on a jeep and took him away. And he says, "Hey, Willie, take my .45 and my bedroll and hang on it for me." He says, "Don't forget, we decided we're going to Paris together." And I looked at him and I says, "Okay, I'll take care of them for you." And of course, we were beyond Paris at the time. Paris was liberated. So when they brought us back out of combat for a rest, they started taking, drawing names. There was two from each battery, and there's five batteries, so that was 10 men at a time got to go to Paris. And I remember Ray and I, when we were in Paris, we were in this particular place where they call it the Avenue of a Thousand Cafes, nightclubs and that. And I remember Ray and I, we walked into that nightclub and there was all combat men there, infantry, artillery, airborne, you name it, Rangers. And he walked in and made the statement that he could lick anybody there. And when he said that, I took off, because I knew I couldn't lick anybody there. So I ran down the street, and a little while later, Ray comes down the street, and he says, "Where'd you go, Willie?" He says, "You're some guy that run off and leave me." I said, "Look, you made a statement that you could lick anybody, and I knew I couldn't." But the guys in my outfit laughed more about that, because that was one of the big jokes in our outfit. But Ray, he, after the war, Ray wouldn't have anything to do with anybody. He never wanted any contact with anybody. You know, he always said, always asked God, he says, "Give me two lives, one to give for my country and one to get home on." That was his motto. But it was strange how we got picked, because you see, they only picked two names. And by golly, our names were picked, and they patched him up, same right back to the A million-dollar wound is when you lose your arms or leg and you can't be of any more use to the Army, so then they send you home. But
You saw a lot of men coming back with their wounds just dressed and put back into combat again.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Oh, yes. Of course, a lot of them got in Sicily. General Bennett, of course, Colonel Bennett at that time, him and I, we had malaria. I remember we were both, of course, we didn't know it till after the war, till we got talking together when David took me down. But he was in a tent near where General Patton slapped that kid. That's known all over. He slapped the kid because he told him he was pretending to be sick and he should be up there with the infantry, you know. And of course, it wasn't very popular for Patton. But we didn't know it, but General Bennett and I were close together. I remember, I was looking for a bathroom. In them days, they had what they call latrines. You just dig a trench and put a canvas around it. And I remember that's the one time that scared me as much as any time. I was scared during the war. I went out and I looked in that trench, and there was arms and legs. And guys had been hurt. You know, that was one of the most scary experiences I would say that I had in reality of what it costs. You know, of course, Omaha was an exception.
Were you wounded at all?
No. No.
You've
asked me how? I don't know. I don't know why. This is what we bought. That's a beach. And that was taken by one of the men of the 62nd Armored Field Artillery Battalion. And he put us some words under it. This is what we bought. And this is what we paid for it.
Were you a prisoner of war at any time?
No.
Okay. And what kind of medals, if at all, were you awarded, or citations or anything?
Well, if you can scan this is a distinguished unit citation that we were given on Omaha Beach. And other outfits were too, but that was a unit outfit. I was awarded, like others in my outfit, this is called the European Theater. The European Theater, Middle Eastern and African Sicilian Campaign. But it represents not just the campaigns, but it represents three landings, and the silver one is Omaha. The first one is Oran, and the second one is Licata, Sicily, and the third one's Omaha. And this is the medal they gave us for the landings and that. Others is Not much to be. Good conduct medal. I don't know how I got that one. And what else we got here? Oh, this is the World War II. Medals are. Now, if you was to ask General Bennett, he's got a thing for them. By the way, I want it made known in this interview that General Donald B. Bennett, at that time Colonel Donald B. Bennett, should have gotten the Medal of Honor, but because there wasn't enough guys left alive, officers, to recommend him for it, he got the next highest, he got the Distinguished Service Cross. And also, he was wounded twice on the beach, but he didn't evacuate. Yeah, we all feel that he was cheated there. He should have got the medal. He may get it yet. The guys are going after it, I know. What's left of us.
So you had a very strong bond with Colonel Bennett and stayed in contact with him.
Well, all of us did. One thing that I'd like to tell you that after the beach, after we got inland, I think it was up around St. Lo, he started acting funny. And he's got it in his book. He's got it in his book. And the guys approached him one night and said, "Don, we want you to go with us someplace." So they took him over and they had a foxhole dug and they had blankets and that down there. He said, "Don, we want you to get down there and we want you to lay down and we want you to rest," because he was completely worn out and he wouldn't give in. And he had a good rest, and he says after that, he says, you know, he says, "I realized that long stretch," because he hadn't slept. He, you know, there's 2 or 3 days there when you didn't do much of anything but just try to stay alive. But they made him lay in that hole until he had a good rest, because he was the kind of guy that was always out there where he shouldn't be. At one time he was out ahead, and they approached this haystack, and out of the haystack came a Mark 6 Tiger tank, and pointed right at him in the Jeep. I don't know who was driving that, whether McGee was driving that, my buddy. I'm not sure who was driving the Jeep that day, but I remember that. In the book it's written how the German put a pistol right to his head, and all of a sudden the shot rang out and the German dropped dead. One of the fellows from the 62nd shot him, because he would have shot Bennett. And that boy, from then on, Bennett, I think, stayed back a little further. He was always out where he shouldn't be, always. Way out in the front. He was no armchair officer. He was a combat officer. Yeah, a good man.
Did you have any interactions with other soldiers, German soldiers, for instance? Did you, either good or bad, their story?
Well, no, not really. Some of the outfit had experiences where outside of St. Lo, they captured several hundred of them, but they gave up because they knew that the odds were against them. But I wasn't in on that at all. No. Mm-hmm. The only thing that I ever remember was I was on patrol with Lieutenant French and I and another fellow they called O'Brien. He was a staff sergeant, and we were on patrol with the I think it was the 9th Infantry Division, and we were going up this path, and we saw this tank smoking, and a couple of guys were on the ground hugging each other and crying and hollering, and as we went by them, we asked, "What's the matter with them guys?" He said, "Well, some Jerry threw a grenade in the tank," and just then, down comes this Jerry with his hands behind his head, and the guy with a rifle nudging him in the back, and come to find out he was one of them that had lobbed that grenade in the tank. But they hadn't gone by me very far, and I heard bang, and apparently they must have shot, which is not supposed to do, but yeah, war is hell. No respect. That's the closest I... We've had them go right by us during the Battle of the Bulge. We were pincered. We were right in the V. A friend of mine right here from Kinderhook, George Wynn, Mr. Wynn, he lost his leg there. He was in a band in England, and they took him out of the band, threw him in the infantry when they had the Battle of the Bulge because they needed men so badly. Mm-hmm. He was only in the line a couple hours, and he lost his leg. And we didn't even know what was going on. You talk about God protecting you. Here we were right in a pincer up in Elsenborn, Germany, and at Malmedy, where they massacred our airborne guys, shot them, tied their hands behind their back and shot them back to the head. All this was going on, and here we were pincered right between it, completely surrounded, and never knew it. Until mm-hmm. after it was over, of course. God watches over you, I guess. That's right. What can you say?
So how, you...
How can so many die and you live? I don't know.
How old were you when you left the service? You entered when you
21.
Were 18 and a half. Okay, so you were 21.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, well, I had my birthday in... Grandma's home, mm-hmm. yeah, and my birthday there, they invited me down. That was when we had come up from Africa, you know, we were staying at Banbury, yeah. I remember I went there for a week. The English people, a lot of people in this country don't realize what rationing really is. The people in England, they knew what rationing was. I remember I was there for a week, and first two mornings I had an egg and what they called a ration of bacon. And on the third day, Wednesday, she said to me, "Lad, I don't have no bacon and I don't have no eggs." She says, "That's our rationing is gone." I thought, my gosh, I ate up their rationing. So I volunteered for KP, and I managed to get a hold of a few cans of pineapple and tomatoes and all kinds of canned goods and sugar and anything else I could get my hands on, which we were all doing and taking to English homes. And I remember I bought a tin of salmon, and I remember Mom said to me, that's Grandma's mother, said to me, "Lad, where did you get these?" She says, "Did you pinch them?" Now in England, when they say pinch, they mean steal.
Oh.
I said, "No, I just borrowed them. Everybody's borrowing food from the kitchen now. The guy's doing it right and left." But I want to tell you something. I want kids to know, whoever sees this, that in England, they knew what rationing was. We went to a home one night, and on each one of our plates was a small piece of ham. But the father and the mother, there was no meat on their plates. And Ray Zilberberg, a guy from California, spoke up and he says, "Don't you people like meat?" And they said, "Well, lads, that's our rationing. We didn't have enough to go around. We wanted you to have it." Well, I guess you know we looted the kitchen again on KP, because we really loaded them up. But those are things people don't realize. They'd wait in line for hours in England, and then the guy come out and say, "That's all." Then he'd give you a little number so that you could start from there the next day. The rationing was very strict. They went without a lot to people in England. They knew what war was. They saw it firsthand.
Well, you spent 424 days in combat during your 2.5 to 3 years in the service.
Yep.
Even though you saw a lot of tragedy and death, it also sounds like you came across a lot of compassion and people demonstrating good things in humanity.
That's right.
In regards to your life when you were in the service, how did you stay in touch with, we know you brought a war bride back to America.
Well, she was a fiancée.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And you know, in regards to your family here in New York, did you have much contact with family and friends while you were in the service?
No, not really. My mother would write. My sister Blanche wrote a couple times, but no, I really didn't have many. The most letters I got was from Betty. She wrote after England and we went into France and that. It was a letter every day. In fact, when you used to have the roll call, you know, you'd go a week or so, and it'd be 6-7 letters for me, and the guy'd holler, "How come you get so much mail? My wife's not writing to me." I always remember that. She wrote every day. Yeah. Every day, no exceptions. Every day she wrote a few lines.
And did you feel like you had plenty of supplies when you were...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
America was united then.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Did you feel a lot of pressure or stress when you were in the service, besides your combat time, but...
No, not really. I was happy-go-lucky, I guess you might say. The only time that things really bothered you is when you'd see the carnage of what was happening in towns and villages, where you go through and see cities leveled, towns leveled, and horses bloated, and cows bloated, and laying on people... Dead people all over the place. I mean, it has to affect you. I'm wondering what's going on.
And you were quite young.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. You grow up quick.
You do grow up quick. What about the camps? I know it's difficult to talk about, and you said that you did pass by one concentration camp. Did you pass by any other ones?
No. The only one we went by, and... I remember as we entered the town, there was a tank, an American tank, all burned up. And a guy, probably he tried to get out, and he was burnt to a crisp. He was on the turret. And just Leipzig, there was a place there, a building where they, we didn't know about it till somebody told us, but they put all the Jews in there, and they bolted all the doors, and they took a bulldozer and put a trench around it. Then they poured gasoline all over the building and set it afire. And of course, if they'd come running out, they'd gun them down anyway. They just went in the trench and they'd cover them up. But the one real bad one was, I didn't get to see it personally, and I'm glad I didn't. Colonel Bennett did. They were going through this town, and the only thing I remember was they asked for volunteers to go in to help. The Jewish people and that. I remember they were walking around, they looked like zombies. They were naked. They were starving. And the GIs were throwing them food and that. And they ate so much, it killed them. Mm-hmm. They weren't used to food.
Right.
But what happened this one particular time was when Bennett was really fired up bad. He almost lost his calm. He was going through this village, they'd just gone by the concentration camp, and this burgomaster, he's like a mayor in a village, came out, and of course the people, the guys were letting them out, they were walking all over the place, these Jewish people, they didn't know where they were going or what, but they just knew they were getting out of that camp, and this mayor, burgomaster, they call him, said to General Bennett, he said, "Herr Colonel," he says, "don't let these people walk around in my village." He says, "They're scaring my people." So Don, the General Bennett, whipped out his pistol, and he was going to blow his brains out. And the guys grabbed him and said, "Don't do it, Don. Don't do it, because then we'll be like them." But that was quite an experience. The guys talked about it. I didn't see it personally, but it really happened. And then as they went through this town, there was a house with people in it. They had Jewish children. They were hiding them. For 2 years, they had never seen the outside world, these children. And when they went by, the people came out. I think it was the man and woman that owned the property there come out, and they said, "Colonel, are you Americans?" And they said, "Yes, we are." And Colonel Bennett says, I could see, looking out the window, I could see the curtain pull back. There's some young faces looking out the window. So he said, Colonel, can I bring them out? And they brought them out. And that's the first time those kids had seen daylight in 2 years. And that affected him terrible. He did. Sometimes it seems like that happens. Hatred rears up, you know, people can be so cruel.
Do you remember where that was, Grandpa?
No.
What village?
I don't remember what town. It's in his book here. Honor Untarnished. Your mother's got it.
Mm-hmm.
Your mother has a copy of that.
I do too, yep.
Yeah. But this one here is from the French people themselves.
Okay.
This was sent over by the man that wrote it. They were on Omaha Beach. And this is the book that they sent to us.
They were on Omaha Beach.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. And on page 39 in this book, there's four of us here. Here's Natborn. He didn't go on invasion with us for D-Day. He was in personnel. But here's Roebuck. He's down near your mom and dad. And there's myself. And there's Casey Williamson. He was killed, Casey. That's the only pictures in here of the 62nd. There should have been a lot more, but this is quite a book. This is written, the first few pages are all French people that were waiting for us to come. They pulled these spikes out of railroad tracks, and they did underground work. They were the French forces in the interior. Great people.
A lot of servicemen and women did things for good luck. Was there anything that you did special for yourself or thought would bring you good luck? Or?
Well, I'll tell you, a lot of guys will say the same thing. When things got tough, we needed God.
Mm-hmm.
But when things straightened out and everything was okay, kind of forgot about God. And that's the way it was.
During your time all the way from Africa to the end of the war, did you ever have entertainers from America come over?
Oh yeah, yeah. In France we had Dinah Shore, and I'll tell you, this'll put a smile on your face. Dinah Shore was singing in an old orchard in France. I remember this. She was in the back of a 6x6 truck. It was raining, just a slow rain. And of course, she was up there singing. And old Bert Coons of our outfit, he was intoxicated. He really had been drinking bad. And he went up and got down, and he knelt down on the ground, and he looked up, and he put his hand, he says, Dinah, he says, will you marry me? We'll never forget that as long as we live. Dinah, sure. You ever hear her?
Oh,
Dinah,
yes.
Sure. So she sang like an angel. Yeah. And then one time in Africa, I didn't get to see... this, but I was told about it, was Bob Hope was over there entertaining, and of course, you know Bob Hope, he was a clip. He was a real soldier's man, I'll tell you. He was a great guy, but he was on the stage, and they had a great big shoe, a giant shoe, and they had a mock air raid. It was our own planes come over, and he ran, he jumped in the shoe. He's crazy. That guy. Jumped in the shoe for protection. Yeah, and who was with him now? I can't think of the singer that was with him. I forgot now. It was Bob Hope. Francis Langford. Yeah, So that's the only two entertainers.
Did you and your fellow brothers ever play pranks on each other?
Well, there's some things that happen that I can't talk about.
Okay. We'll respect that.
Not really. We didn't have much time for that, really, but occasionally it happened. Yeah. Remember one guy, though, up in McNassie, North Africa. We were hit real bad there. In fact, that was the time when the Panzer units overran the American forces because they were all hardened. They were hardened soldiers. I mean, they were the elite of the German army, and we were kids. And I remember up there one time, one guy, a shell actually landed right in his foxhole with him, but it didn't detonate. And he got out of the foxhole, and boy, I'll tell you, the air was blue. But he said, you know, he says, God let me live today. He says, I'm going to behave from now on. A few minutes later, he was swearing like a trooper. These are things that happened during the war. There's not too much humor in it.
What did you think of your fellow officers and soldiers during your time?
Privileged and honored to serve with the 62nd Army Field Artillery Battalion. They were, of course, maybe I haven't mentioned this, but they were all well trained. They were trained in the Mojave Desert and that. Some of them remember Rommel, who was our deadly enemy. Rommel was the head of the German army, and he trained with Patton in the Mojave Desert, and they did too. They trained there. Some of these guys, the outfit I went in, were mostly married men. They were, you know, in their 30s up. They were all seasoned guys, but, yeah.
Were you one of the youngest?
Yeah, I was the youngest guy in my battery, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. In fact, Marie and I went out to the 50th anniversary, 1994, out at Tulsa, Oklahoma. And the other guy there was 2 months that separated. He was 2 months younger than I, but he's passed on now. I'm the youngest left now. The oldest is 98. I just got a letter from him out in Missouri. Louis Israel, his name is.
And how old are you today, Gramps?
I'm 84.
You're 84. Do you think that your fellow soldiers and the officers, because of their age, treated you differently? Did they protect you more, or?
Well, you know, in time of war, everybody becomes a brother. Mm-hmm. You watch each other's backs and that. I mean, there was never any problem with that. The only thing I got picked on for was I was a northerner. You know, Roebuck always says, if you don't get down here soon, the Civil War is going to start all over again.
Did you keep a personal diary at all?
No.
During your time? No. Okay. So, do you recall the day that the service ended for you?
Well, you mean when I was discharged?
It could be when you're discharged, or maybe when combat ended and the war ended.
This was in 19. It was in 1945, where we linked up with the Russians on the Elbe River in Czechoslovakia. You know, that was the end of the war, and the sad part of it was, the war was over, but it hadn't been. A lot of the combat forces had not been contacted yet, and the last fellow was killed. I forgot his name now. It was in Czechoslovakia. He was the last one killed in World War II there. Yeah.
And were you with him?
No.
Or?
No, I didn't even know him. No, I didn't even know him. I just heard about it. Yeah.
Okay, and so you were with the Russians at the time when the war ended.
Well, we had a lot of problems with the Russians, a lot of problems. In fact, one night we decided again to borrow a Jeep from the motor pool, they were all put in this motor pool, and the gate was locked, but somebody somehow had a key to open it with, and we borrowed a Jeep, and we drove to Pilsen. Now, Pilsen's very famous for beer, a big brewery there. So there was a guy named Sandro Bly, and he was from Ringtown, Pennsylvania, and he spoke French, German, Russian, and Italian. He spoke for, he was our interpreter. And we went to this place at Pilsen. It was a big brewery, and we backed the Jeep up there because we wanted to get back before dark. And there was some Russians walking up and down on the dock where you backed up to, and they had their submachine. We had no weapons or nothing. We, the war was over for us, but for them. But anyway, we backed up, and Sandro says, I'm going up and see if I can get us a couple kegs of beer. So he went up and he started talking to this Czech guy, and the Czech guy says, I'm sorry, but the Russians have bought it all. And Sandro was really mad. He says, don't you tell me they buy things. They don't buy nothing, they steal it. He says, someday they're going to take everything you got. You know, you talk about prophecy. Only a few years later, they run over the Czechs, and we didn't even help them. Mm. Yep. But old Sandro Bly, he was quite a guy. He had big veins in his face. They stuck out like arteries. And we found out from him that he had been in a coal mine in Pennsylvania, down where he lived in Pennsylvania. And the blast that occurred in the mine while he was there caused his veins to rupture. And that's how that got about for him. He was quite a guy. Sandro Bly, he was a busy man. He never knew where he was going to be.
Do you remember the days and weeks after you were, the war ended and everyone was liberated?
Well, they put us all in different camps, and they named them all after cigarettes. I was in Camp Lucky Strike.
Okay.
And yes, each camp was a cigarette name. Jackson, I don't know where they put Jackson, but they sent me to England, to Tidworth. And when I got there, I found out that if you volunteered to stoke the stoves for the cooks, you work 2 days, you get 3 days off. Man, I grabbed that job quick. And this is another time I didn't tell you about, but in Tidworth, we went to the pub to have a drink, and while I was there, when I came out, I'm walking down the street, and here comes Jackson again. See, they sent him to England. I didn't know it. And then he sent me to England. So I told him I hadn't seen Betty yet. I said, well, you better call her up right away. So I did. I called Mom up, and she said, where are you? I says, I'm in Tidworth, England. She said, oh, come on home, come on home. But that's how Jackson and I got tied up again together. I'd work 2 days, get 3 days off, so pretty good deal. That's how everybody was actually mustered out through the different camps and that. Now some because of Purple Hearts and different things, they sent them home first. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So how long were you at the Lucky Strike camp?
Oh, maybe a couple days. That's all. And it sent us right on. Kept moving us because they had to keep the troops moving. There's so many of them, you know,
okay,
mustering out. But I had no idea I was going to England till they finally told us at the dock in France that we were going over to England. And, so back to England I went. I was there from, I was there about a month and a half.
Month and a half?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then they put us on a boat. Of course, Jackson and I split up at Tidworth, and then didn't know it, but we were on the same boat going home, never knew it, till we got to Boston Harbor.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and when we got there, we were told there was a little ship, little boat that came up, and it had all ribbons on it. It says, welcome home, and I forgot the name on it, and found out that this woman on this boat was a nurse, and her husband was an officer on the ship we were on, and she was singing, I'll be home for Christmas, you can count on me. And the first song I ever heard back in the States was that song.
Oh.
And they took us in and put us in these little huts, and they said, now, whatever you want to eat, you can have whatever you want. Well, I remember I had a steak.
You had a steak?
Yep. You could have anything you wanted. This was, they treated us the same way before we went to Omaha, too.
Hmm.
Yeah, always remember that, too. They fed us very good the night before we got on the ship. And you talk about contact with English people. I'll always remember that night we were going down to the boats, that all the English people were out with their teapots and their crumpets and things that they make, you know, their pastries, and thanking us for coming over and hollering, good luck, Yanks, as we went. They knew where we were going. Yeah.
That was before you left for D-Day.
Before we left for D-Day, yep. Yeah. Yeah, a lot of things come back to you.
And, did you go to school when you came back to the States at all?
The first thing I had to do was, Betty's mom and dad told me that she couldn't come over to this country until I had a job and a home for her. They were very protective. So I went down to Kinderhook, New York, to this big fruit farm, and I applied for a job and as a tenant farmer. And then I contacted them, told them I had a job and a place to bring her back to. And then I had another snag. In order to get her back here, I had to post a $500 bond, which I didn't have. So I went to Elliot Smith, my employer at the time, and I told him, well, there's no problem at all. He says, come on, we'll go up to the bank. So I went up to the bank and got it. That was in case. See, some of the war brides were brought over and left stranded.
Mm.
And that was so they could go back home again, have their fare.
Okay.
So that's what it was for.
Okay.
After she arrived, he got his bond money right back.
And how long was it before you brought Elizabeth Hodson from England here to be your bride?
I got back October 21st, 1945, and in August of 1947, I was working in the silo on the farm, and somebody hollered, come on down out of there, you got a telegram, it's over in Chatham at the Western Union, which they don't have anymore here, and I went over, and it was a telegram from Mom and Dad in England. Said, Betty aboard the Marine Flasher arriving in August. I forgot what they said now, August something. Forgot now the exact date. And that I was to meet her there. So my brother-in-law, Bill, you don't remember Bill Davenant, my sister's, Lillian's husband, but he took me down to meet her and that. And she came over on the Marine Flasher, and I met her. And then when she came over here, we walked from Kinderhook over to Valatie to Pastor Becker's mother, mm-hmm. Nick's mother, and we got our marriage license. And I remember we walked down to Austin's appliance store. We had no furniture. We had nothing. In fact, we had an old table we got out of a cellar next door, and that thing had cobwebs galore under it. We cleaned that all up, and we got apple crates, and we sat on them for chairs. We had nothing, no furniture at all. And I remember that when we went to see him, we told him we needed a washing machine to wash our clothes with.
The light's on.
I don't know what's going on. It's good. Okay.
And he said, well, you look like good kids. He says, you're working for Elliot Smith. I know him. He says, you'll pay for it. So we asked him how much it would be a month. And he said $8 and something for the washer payment. So anyway, he brought it right over, the wash machine, to the house. And that night, as we left the store, he said to Grandma, to Betty, he says, "You know, young lady," he says, "everybody needs a present." And he reached up on the shelf and he picked up a beautiful Westinghouse toaster and gave it to her. He was a great guy. He was a great guy, Al Austin. Yep. Well,
before we go forward, we're going to switch. You want to switch out the memory card? Did you say we have 15 minutes left? Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's do that. Let's take a break, and then I'm going to wrap this up with talking about your friendships after the service. Okay? Yeah. And then we can...
On 12/28/2007 with Harold Williams interview.
Okay. Okay, let's continue. And we're going to start out with how many different countries did you visit? Or did you go through?
Not a visit.
Let's not call it a visit, right?
All right, we'll start with Algeria, Tunisia, Morocco, Sicily, England, France, Belgium, Holland, Germany, Czechoslovakia.
Okay. And how many different campaigns were you involved with?
Seven campaigns. Well, here. I'll tell you, this is way right here, because they send it every year when we renew her. Okay, here we go. Tunisia, Sicily, Normandy, Ardennes-Alsace, that's France. Northern France, the Rhineland, that's Germany. Central Europe, they didn't get Czechoslovakia on here. I wonder why they don't have that on here, because that's where we wound up. They don't have Czechoslovakia on here. I'll be doggone. Distinguished Unit Citation, Normandy Beachhead, they got that on here. I'll be doggone. That's the first time I ever noticed that. Because that was very important in Czechoslovakia, because that was a very trying time. It could have been World War III. Because all we had done for the Soviets, sent them millions upon millions and billions of dollars worth of war material, and kept them from being conquered by Adolf. Communism.
How long were you in the in Czechoslovakia for?
We were there about probably a month.
Okay.
Yeah, about a month.
And a lot happened while you were there.
Oh yeah, we had a lot of problems. Yeah. I got a picture taken with a couple of the guys in my outfit. We were arguing with the Russians because they wanted something, the chickens or something, and we didn't let them through. And they were like us, out scouting around, you know, but they were stealing from people's homes, taking everything, and molesting young girls. It was real bad. The Russians were like animals. See, they had lost millions of men in the war. Millions. They lost untold number of men in the war.
What were your experiences, if any, with Patton, Eisenhower, Bradley?
Okay, the only contact that we had with Eisenhower, he did visit the airborne just before they left to go in ahead of us in the Normandy. But on the boats, they passed out a pamphlet to everybody, and it was from Eisenhower. It says, comrades, the eyes of the world are upon you, and the hopes of all the things that we've tried to accomplish, we hope that this will bring a quick end to the war and that. So God bless you, and what else? That was it. That was the only contact. I never had a personal contact with him. With Bradley, no, I didn't really shake hands. Some of the guys did. Shook hands with him, but I never did. And who's the other one?
And Patton.
And Patton, well, he decorated our men in Sicily and some in Germany, too. I saw him up close, but I never shook hands or anything with him.
Okay.
Blood and Guts, they called him. Blood and Guts Patton.
In regards to the brothers that you served with, did you make close friendships after the war with any of them?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there's several of them there, but the closest one is McGee out, Russ and Bonnie out. In fact, they just called the other night. Yeah, him and I are about, he's a year older than I am. And Russ was with Bennett a lot. He drove a Jeep for him. Bennett got him in some tight places. And that's, and of course, Ike. What happened to Ike? What happened to Ike? Oh, here it is. Ike used to call me. Get this right up close. That was taken in Czechoslovakia. Ike was a fellow that every year, June 6, 1944, the phone would ring and I'd pick it up. He says, Cornwelly, have you got your ticket to cross the channel with today? June 6, he'd call me. He died last year. Like,
I'm sorry to hear that.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, like, yeah.
Have you become involved with veterans organizations since you've been out of the war?
Well, yeah, I belong to the VFW and the American Legion, both, yeah.
Okay.
Of course, I keep in close contact with Tiford Roebuck down there by your mom. Mm-hmm. And Ted Brink is down below you in West Palm, but we think he's having a memory problem. Because he repeats himself a lot in that. He was with Bennett on D-Day.
Mm-hmm.
He was the one that Bennett turned around to because he was quite a ways out in the water. He said, hey, come on, Brink, you're holding up the war. That's, you might say, one of the humorous sides.
Did your military experience influence your thinking about war in general and the military?
Well, I believe that all of us in there was only thinking about one thing, is just to get the job over with and get back home. I mean, some guys stayed in, you know,
mm-hmm.
But me, I couldn't wait to get out. I wanted out.
How did your experience in the military and the war affect your life? And your experiences in life?
You know, when I stopped to think of it, when I came back from the service, I forgot all about the war. I didn't try to dwell upon it or anything, and I just didn't think much about it. As far as affecting you, it has to affect you. I mean, the comradeship that you had, you wouldn't take any money for it. The money can't buy it. There's a lot of times when You know, you lay your head on a pillow at night and you'd think, wow, I got to come home. That's a big thing. A lot of them never had a homecoming. One thing that affected me since I've been back, I was getting my hair cut one day, guy at a barber here on the main street in Valatie. And we got talking, and he said, you were on Omaha Beach, and I said, yeah. He says, so was my brother Charlie, and he was in the 29th, and he was landing to the right of me. We never even, this is after the war, huh? He's gone now too, Charlie. He got hit a couple times. He was with the 29th Division. He was landing to the right of us. I guess most of us just want to forget it all, you know, try to put it behind. You never really ever forget it, but life has to go on. And I guess most of us were so glad to get back on terra firma USA that the big majority, probably 99%, just said, get me out of this uniform, get me back in the civvies.
Is there anything in regards to this interview that we haven't covered that you would like to state to whoever is going to see this?
Will young people be seeing this?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, just remember, you young folks out there, that there's no country like America in the world. There's none like us. We got our faults. We're not perfect, but we're the freest people on earth. Free to do things that in other countries you can't even begin to think of doing. And I would say to all the young people, go on down to Washington and look at all those silver stars and see how much it costs. And if young people got enough money and they want to take a vacation, go over to Omaha Beach and go up off the beach and look at the 9,700 and some men buried there. Yeah. Very expensive, your freedom. Very. And now we got people coming into our country that wants to change us all around. They've forgotten what the real history of America is. They're not teaching it in the schools anymore. They're not teaching true history. They're teaching what they want to teach to the young people. But I believe that America was truly God-ordained, God-blessed, because there's no other country in the world like it. Although it's rapidly changing into something that is not good. So I would advise the young people to cherish their freedom, and if they ever stop thinking about it, just visit a few of the veteran cemeteries. See what it cost. I'm very disturbed over flag burning. Very disturbed over that. I don't worship no flag. I don't think people in the country worship the flag, but I respect it. I respect what it stands for.
Grandpa, what would you say to young war veterans coming back? Now, do you ever heal from war?
Whatever what?
Do you ever heal from war?
I don't think so. I think sometimes you try to kid yourself that you do, but you never really do. how can you ever forget when you're walking through a field and there, every few yards, lays a dead American soldier. He'd give his life for that terra firma over there. I don't know.
Your relationship with other brothers in your unit and your faith, has that helped you to be able to have as much peace within yourself that you can?
Yeah, I know that if I didn't trust the Lord and that, I know things could be a lot worse, because then, you know, the Bible says that He will keep you in perfect peace when your mind is stayed upon Him. When I look back at what I went through, I have no conception of God's great love for me at all. I mean, I knew nothing about the Bible, and I lived from day to day, gung-ho, just like the average GI did. But I know one thing, that I know for sure, that God's hands was surely upon me, because I can think of the many tight places that I got into, and others got hurt and killed or wounded, and I didn't. So God must have had His hand on me. That's the only thing I can figure out. And I'm here today because God wants me here. I guess He's got work for me to do.
That He does.
Yeah.
When you went to the World War II Memorial Service in Washington, how important was that for you?
Well, gosh, the people I met down there, some people would walk up to you, and, you know, they'd say thanks and that, and that helped to heal too. Some families do appreciate what you've done, and but, you know, I always think when somebody says that to you, I always think, well, and I always say to them, just remember the ones that didn't make it. They're the ones that we owe everything to. They made the supreme sacrifice. I think if there's one thing that I'll always remember, is how I heard guys tell how they heard other guys crying for their mother. I don't think you ever forget that.
And you went on to have 4 children, 1 that joined the military.
Yep.
Who's here today, who
yep.
we...
An old CB.
David Williams.
Yep.
And how was that for you when he decided to join the military?
Well, I was real proud of him, because, you know, I think any father has been in the service himself is always proud when you see one of their own going into the service. Yep.
And did
I'm
your...
I'm just glad he didn't have to go in a time of great conflict.
Do you think that would have changed your mind in regards to...
Yeah, probably would have. I think the people that have got their sons and daughters over there in Iraq and Afghanistan, wow, what we don't owe them is not mentionable. Wow. We owe them everything. To think that they would even want to, you know, the people who hate us. And yet, God is using it all. I don't think many people are aware that right now, in the Muslim nations, more people are coming to recognize that their religion has led them astray. See, religion always leads people astray because the real life is about a person, Christ. And as I understand it today, my own personal church, we have a big church in Baghdad. We do, the Christian Missionary Alliance. We have a big church in Baghdad right now. It's run by a guy he's an Arab, and I believe when we leave there, I believe that's the end of his life, because they'll kill them all. There's over 2,000 attend that church now, Iraqis. And they're beginning to find out that their religion is very false. Muhammad is not the prophet, and Allah is not God. It's not mentioned anywhere in Scripture. This is all man-made religion, just like a lot of denominations have. And I believe today that people, unless we return back to God, I believe our nation is doomed. I don't see any other way out. We have thrown God out of our schools, and many of our churches do not preach the God of the Bible. We've decided that we know more than God, and the filth and the stuff that's spewed out over television tubes today, America's got to turn from that. Even our enemies don't believe in some of the things that are going on right here in this nation. So I would say America has got to remember that when things are going bad, then we kind of think we need God. And then when things are going good, we don't need Him anymore. That's not the way it works. God has blessed America, and I pray that this testimony will be a help to young people in the generation today to realize that with religion, you're doomed. You need the person. You need Christ. And that's why God sent Him to this earth, to die for a sinner like me. And the people need to hear that. They need to hear the truth of what the Bible says, not what somebody thinks, or what somebody thinks the Bible says, but what the Bible actually says. When we turn back to that, America will be healed. Until then, America is on the road to destruction. And I'm not making that a gloom and doom. It's in fact, we can see it every day. So America better wake up. There's an evil within the country. And that's what one of the greatest men in all history said, that America will never be defeated by a foreign nation, but by an enemy within the country itself. And one of the biggest enemies is the ACLU, the American Civil Liberties Union. They do not represent anything good for America. They've gotten into our schools, and now our teachers are under the influence and power of the ACLU and all the other elements that are out to destroy us. So young people, wake up. Wake up. Turn back to God, because that's the only hope for our nation. Anything on our own efforts will fail. And that's my conclusion. That Solomon in the Bible wrote that all is vanity. He looked around and he saw everything. He had wealth untold, but he lacked one thing. He lacked his faith in God, which he later turned to. And that's what America has to do. I hope this interview will help some young people in our nation. The older ones do.
Well, Grandpa, I thank you for doing this interview today for the Library of Congress on December 28th, 2007. And I'd like to get some video of perhaps some still photos here. We could do that.
Oops. This is from the 62nd?
Yep, this is the 60. And on the back side, it's got the...
That's a great
There's a back side, too. I want to turn over. I want to show you something.
Okay.
Show you with an old outfit. On the bottom, you'll see the old horse artillery.
How old is that unit?
Oh my gosh.
World War One, if it's a horse unit.
Oh, well, they go way back, yeah.
Yeah.
But see, we had the mechanized M7s.
David, let's
They call them a priest tank.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because they had a pulpit on them in the back, raised up with a machine, a big 50 caliber, like a preacher would stand in, so they call them a priest tank.
Yeah. Oh, and maybe I'll get in on the shot so we can do the introductions.
That's the different campaigns there, too.
I'm Julie, the granddaughter.
This is David.
I'm David, his son.
Three generations. Now, this is a letter from...
General Bennett. Where we do that? Back here, I wonder. Let me see if I told you people correct here. You want me to read this?
If you want to. If you feel it's important to add.
Yeah. This is a letter from General Donald V. Bennett. He was a colonel during the wartime service with him. And he had just lost his wife, too, whom that he looked forward to coming home to. He spent a few years with her, but... And God took her home, and he wrote this letter to me. It's kind of a personal letter, and in this letter, he said, "Thank you so much for your wonderful letter. I shall never forget your young son. I know he enjoyed that about that time that we both had together. It was my good fortune to be able to spend some time with you. Your memory of D-Day is still sharp and correct. The people in the States were fortunate, for they did not have to witness the beach at Omaha on D-Day and D+1. It was a memory of all of us who were on the beach, and both of us were fortunate. We saw firsthand the carnage there, and we are still alive today. And I know you join me in that we had an opportunity to do our best for our country. May God bless you and your family. Don Bennett. It's a man we served all through the war with. And I made a statement in this interview that I wondered why God spared me. And my daughter wrote something here from the 91st Psalm, the 7th and 14th verses. There's 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. Because he loves you, but he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. Psalm 91, verses 7 and 14. And up behind it, on where we were in Washington, it has the D-Day memorial words, D-Day, June 6, 1944. These are the words of General Eisenhower. You are about to embark upon a crusade toward which you have striven these many months, and the eyes of the world are upon you. And with full confidence in your courage and your duty and skill in battle. That was a personal letter he handed to every single person that was on that D-Day invasion. And, I think that was the moment when we realized that this is the real thing. Three armored field artillery battalions equipped with 105 millimeter M7 Priest tanks were assigned to the assault divisions at Normandy. On Omaha, the 62nd Armored Field Artillery supported the 1st Division Infantry, and the 58th Artillery supported the 29th Division. And on Utah Beach, the 65th supported the 4th Division. On D-Day morning, the only rounds that the 62nd fired was 349 rounds at the beach on the morning of D-Day. That's all we fired. The rest of the tanks were lost, so they didn't bring any more in.
Thank you.
May God bless America.